Good morning, church. If you would please stand and let's worship God together.
Good morning. Welcome. I'm so glad that you're here today. I hope that you've had a good 4th of July weekend, and we're going to talk a little bit about that during the course of the morning. But if you're a guest today, if you've never filled out one of our communication cards, I would just invite you sometime during the service to do that. If you stop by Welcome Central as you leave today, we'd like to give you a gift and got some information about the church that we'd be glad to put in your hands as well. I heard a story, it's been several years ago now, about three guys, Bill, Tom, and Bob, and they decided to go on this hunting trip together. So it was, it was a deer camp, and Saturday morning they got up early, and Bill and Tom went one direction, and Bob went the other, and they spent all day out hunting. Well, it was way after dark. Bob had been back for hours, and finally Tom comes dragging in, and he's pulling this 10-point buck, and he hauls it into camp. And he says, well, man, where's Bill? And he said, well, about a mile back, he had just exerted himself so much dragging this deer that he passed out. And so he said, you mean to tell me that you drug that deer a mile and you left him passed out in the woods? And he said, well, I admit it was a tough decision, but I figured nobody would steal Bob. So, you know, sometimes you got to make a tough call. You know, you got to decide what's most important. And we're going to talk today about what's important and deciding what's important and then what that does in us once we decide. Let's pray and we'll continue on. God, thanks for today. Thank you, Lord, that we can gather here in your name. Thank you for this time of year, this season, this holiday when we remember our freedom. And we remember so many who've paid such a high price that we can enjoy it. Thank you that we can gather in your name without fear today. Thank you that we come together to celebrate. And thanks for those who worship with us online, that we can share together as a family through Christ. God, guide us, we pray. Give us wisdom. And that's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
The sun sets free. Oh, it's
yes, I am. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Have a seat. Okay, quiz time again today. We celebrate 4th of July. Why? It's Independence Day. Okay, what was signed on the 4th of July? Nicely done. Sad to say, when you see certain questionnaires and things online, there are people who can't answer that question, so I thought that I would check with you. Make sure you had that down pat. Declaration of Independence. Did you know that Jesus made one of those? That Jesus made a declaration of independence on the cross. When he said, "It is finished," he had accomplished what he set out to do. He had brought independence to us in a profound way. And I want to read to you a verse that is in Romans chapter 6. It's verse 22. It says, "You have been set free. You've been set free from sin, and you've become slaves to God. The benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life." All right, let me say that again. You've been set free from your sin, so now you're a slave to God. The result is holiness, and the promise is eternal life. You've been set free. Now, in the Revolution of America, they signed it on July 4, 1776, and then there were like 5 years of war. And so it wasn't like everybody was instantly free, but they had been declared free. And then the process began. Jesus died offering us freedom, and then the process begins because we get to decide whether or not we're in on this or not. But he declared us free on the cross. And so as we gather for communion each week, it's an opportunity for us to kind of remember what Jesus has done for us. And if you haven't been here sort of during our social distancing practices, we've got communion set up in five different places around the room. And in just a moment after I pray, we're going to play a song. And just during the song, at some point, you're invited to just get up and go to one of the stations. The communion cups are stacked. There's bread on the bottom cup and then juice on the top. You just take both and partake, and then you can just drop your cups in the trash cans there. And just remember, social distancing may not mean anything to you, but for some people, that's important. And so just kind of space out. There'll be plenty of time for everybody to get to a table and get served. Okay? So let's pray, and then we'll allow this time to reflect on Jesus. Father, we thank you that we're free, that through Christ we have been declared free, free from our sins, free to serve you. We reap the benefit of holiness and the promise of eternal life. Thank you. And we thank you for the freedom that we enjoy today, that we can gather here because of the freedom in our country. But even more significant is the freedom that we have through Jesus Christ, and so we praise you for that. We remember now, Lord Jesus, what you did for us on the cross. We're grateful for all that you've done. And we just affirm again to you today our commitment. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
I am a child. You want to know how to win a sword fight?
Hell.
Be the only one with a sword.
Come on, Edgar!
Easy.
Give him a hand. He fought well.
Well done, John.
Winner takes all, my friends. Winner takes all. One more challenger and I'll be on my way.
Come on. You can take him.
As sure as the sun will rise tomorrow, somewhere, there's a man who's better than me. Could be here. Could be today.
Go on.
Yeah!
Could be you. Looks strong. Hmm. Is he good?
Try him and see.
Yeah, give
him a try. Go on, Mark. Only don't hurt him.
It's you, Mark, are you?
That's my name.
I'm Lancelot. You ready?
Ready.
You'll fight your man.
Well, you don't have to kill me to win, you know. That tight hold of your sword?
You worry about that!
Good. Now, can I give you some advice?
What's that?
Don't drop your sword. Well done.
Give him a hand!
Well done, Mark.
How did you do that? How did he do that?
Oh, well done, mate. You fought a good fight.
Was that a trick? No. No trick. It's a way of fight.
Could I do it? Tell me. I can learn.
You have to study your opponent, how he moves, so you know what he's going to do before he does it.
I can do that.
Mm. You have to know that one moment in every fight, when you win or lose, and you have to know how to wait for it.
I can do that.
And you have to not care whether you live or die.
There's a phrase that we've been hearing a lot these days. Some people think it's real. Some people think it's fake. It's an emotionally charged phrase. Everybody has an opinion about it. Nobody's neutral about it. It elicits a strong response from everybody who hears it. It's a phrase that makes some people defensive. It's a phrase that makes other people feel vindicated for, well, how they feel. It's a phrase I'm going to share with you in just a second. Some of you aren't going to really like that I bring it up. Other of you might kind of be mad at me for talking about it in church. This phrase is not the main point of my sermon today, but there is a word in the phrase that is kind of a key part of what we're going to talk about. And so it just seemed like I ought to bring it up because it's the elephant in the room. So take a deep breath. Okay, the phrase is white privilege. Now, some people get all worked up and defensive about the phrase white privilege because maybe they just don't exactly understand what the phrase means. White privilege does not mean that white people never struggle or that they have it easy. White privilege doesn't mean that white people don't have problems. White privilege doesn't mean that white people live a charmed life. White privilege doesn't mean that white people did not work for what they have. It basically means that under the same set of circumstances, white people in America often have greater access to resources and benefits than people of other races. I mean, you think about it. America is more than 70% white. And because we are in the majority when it comes to race, then with everything else being equal, we typically have greater opportunities and greater access to resources than others. Now, this phrase has changed meaning over the centuries of our country's history. 160 years ago, white privilege was pretty obvious because if you were white, you could own somebody of color. It's a horrible part of our past, but it is a part of our past. 60 years ago, white privilege was pretty obvious because it decided where you could go to the bathroom and decided where you could sit on the bus and it decided where you could go to school. Right now in our country, tensions are running high because of shootings, because of peaceful demonstrations, because of riots, because of defunding arguments, because of Black Lives Matter, because of Back the Blue, and on and on and on it goes. Now, we're not going to solve all that today. That's not our purpose, and if only it were that easy. But I want to address the idea that some people in the world have privilege over other people. And the community that we live in, it's easier to blend in if you're white. Now, it doesn't mean that you're better than somebody else. It doesn't make me better than anybody else. It just is easier. That's a privilege that I benefit from, whether I want to or not. I don't know what it's like to be black in America. There are places that I've traveled in the world where I was in the extreme minority. And even though it was just a tiny glimpse of what that felt like, I mean, I was photographed, I was pointed at, talked about all around me as if I wasn't there. There were people who kind of put me up on a pedestal because I was white, and there were people who were pretty critical, and they ostracized me because I was white. White privilege, at least partly, is just majority privilege. It's just easier to blend in than to not. Doesn't make it right. We shouldn't perpetuate it. It's just a thing. And to act like it's not a thing, I think, is not to be realistic. So rather than denying it, rather than arguing about it, what we might want to do is recognize that it's not always easy to be the minority, whether it's racially, whether it's religiously, whether it's culturally. It's usually easier to be in the majority. Now, I would suggest that it's easier to be in the minority if those in the majority are open to you, and if they're gracious to you, and if they're kind to you, and if they build bridges with you, it's just easier. That's why it's the responsibility of those who are in the majority to show compassion and grace to those who might be minimized at best or demonized at worst. Now, what does all this have to do with church today? It's like, why can't we just leave all that stuff out there so we can talk about other stuff in here? Well, 20 years ago, I preached a sermon, and the title of it was Privilege Brings Responsibility. That because we have blessings through Christ, then rather than taking those blessings for granted, we need to understand that we have responsibilities that come because of the privileges, because of the blessings that we have. We aren't just loved. We're supposed to show love. We don't just receive grace. We grant grace to other people. We don't just have the benefit of forgiveness of sins because of the cross. We actually take up our cross and follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Privilege brings responsibility. And that's what I want to talk about today. Just like because we live in America, those blessings bring responsibilities. Because we have a relationship with Jesus, that beautiful privilege also suggests certain expectations that God has given to us. Luke 14, 25 begins this way. It says, large crowds were traveling with Jesus. These were people who had seen his miracles. They had heard him teach. They watched him put the Pharisees in their place. Man, hanging out with Jesus was exciting. It was fun. People were just totally thrilled to be there with him. But Jesus needed them to understand that there's more to being a disciple than just being part of the crowd. That Jesus isn't just looking for spectators. He doesn't just want casual fans. Jesus wants fully devoted followers. And so he actually talked to the crowd that day, and he suggested three responsibilities that come out of the blessing, the benefit, the privilege of following him and being part of his family. And it's here in Luke 14. There are three areas of commitment that help us stay centered on Christ. Okay? It's priorities, surrender, and consistency. Responsibilities. The first one is priorities. Luke 14, 25 again. Listen, and we'll read on. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, now you ready for this? If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. I mean, those verses are hard to even read out loud. You kind of picture Jesus, he's walking down the road, maybe he's kind of in a meditative frame of mind, and people are walking along behind him, waiting for him to say something. It's kind of like that scene in Forrest Gump where he's running across America and all those people are running behind him and they're just running and he's being quiet and they're following him. And all of a sudden he stops and he turns around and everybody holds their breath because they think he's going to say something really profound. And in typical Forrest Gump fashion, he says, I'm kind of tired. I think I'll go home now. And that was not what they were expecting, and then it was just done. Well, Jesus is walking along, and all of a sudden he turns around, and everybody holds their breath. What's he going to say? And he basically says, I want you to hate everybody except me. Really? I mean, really? I was tempted to skip this section of the Gospel of Luke because it'd be easier to go on to chapter 15 and just not talk about this. What could Jesus mean? You're supposed to hate your mom and dad, your spouse and your kids, even hate yourself. I mean, it wasn't too long ago that Jesus said, love your neighbors as you love yourself. My father-in-law, Lewis Foster, Gail's dad, is a Bible scholar, and he wrote the notes, in Luke and Acts in the NIV Study Bible. And he says that here, Jesus is using a vivid hyperbole, which is a drastic exaggeration to prove a point. Jesus is saying, look, our love for God should far exceed every other love. Love for anything else, love for anybody else, so that if you compare your love for anything else to your love for God, that love would seem like hate in comparison. Let me suggest it to you this way. Maybe you've heard me say this before. We talked about this in Sunday school a few months ago. Imagine a scale from 1 to 10, 1 being hate and 10 being love. On a scale from 1 to 10, the difference in hate and love is 10 points. It's almost like Jesus is saying, okay, if hate is here and love for your family, friends, neighbors, everybody else is here, 1 to 10, your love for God needs to be 20. It needs to be so much more that by comparison, it's like the difference in love and hate. Now, is that exactly what he meant? That's all I can figure out in this text. But this is a hard text. What it boils down to is that Jesus is saying, nothing can take the place of God in your life. Nothing. Not love for self, not love for others, not love for your family, not even love for your country. I mean, do we love ourselves? We're supposed to. Do we love our family and friends? Well, of course. Do we love our country? As messed up as it is right now, we love it, yes. But we love God more. It's why the first two of God's Ten Commandments, he said, you're to love, or you're to have no other gods before me, and actually that could be translated, no other gods besides me, and you're not to make an idol. You're not to make an object of worship. See, God knew how easy it would be for us to put other people up on a pedestal, or to put money, or children, or patriotism, or things center in our lives. And he didn't want that to happen. He wanted to make sure that we understood that he's supposed to be number one. You know who learned that the hard way? Abraham in the Old Testament. You remember Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation? God promised Abraham that he would have a son who would become the ancestor of the people of God. And God waited 25 years to keep that promise to Abraham and his wife Sarah. 25 years. He waited till Abraham was 100 years old, Sarah was 90 years old when Isaac was born. I love what Max Lucado said. Sarah was the only woman in town who paid her pediatrician with her Social Security check. This is crazy. Abraham and Sarah were as happy could be. They named their son Isaac, which means laughter, because they were so happy. And then God told Abraham to take Isaac, the center of their world, up onto Mount Moriah and sacrifice him there as a burnt offering to the Lord. It took God 25 years to fulfill the promise, and a few years later, he told Abraham to kill the promise. Are you kidding me? This doesn't make any sense at all. Now, the Bible tells us right away that this is only a test, so we can take a deep breath and relax. He was only testing Abraham, but Abraham didn't know it was a test. Abraham received this unimaginable commandment from God, and he said, okay. And he took Isaac to Mount Moriah. And the Bible says that Abraham was stopped by God before he went through with this, and God provided a ram for the sacrifice. He allowed Isaac to live. But I want you to imagine that the battle that must have been going on in Abraham's heart and his mind, realizing that to say yes to God right now means he has to say no to the dream of his life. That saying yes to God meant saying no to the deepest longings of his heart. Now, on the one hand, it's impossible for us to understand and get our mind around what God said to Abraham, because God would never ask something like that of us. Only he kind of does when he says here that our love for God is to be so extreme that all other kinds of love are going to feel like hatred by comparison. Man, that's just hard. But he says, if you want the privilege of belonging to God, receiving mercy and grace, forgiveness of sins, the gift of eternal life, then the responsibility is to put him before everything else. It's a matter of priorities. Now, there's a second thing here, and it's the idea of surrender. Verse 27, Jesus says, anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Privilege brings responsibility. Anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. If you want to be a follower of Jesus, you want to be a member of his family, you need to know what you're getting into. You got to be willing to carry a cross. Now, what does that even mean? Well, it meant a whole lot in Jesus' day. A man named Skip Gray wrote a book called The Way of the Cross, and he explains that we kind of learn from tradition and through history that around the time Jesus was a teenager, there was a rebellion in that area in Galilee. And the Roman army crushed the rebellion, but they didn't want it to happen again. And so they crucified an Israelite approximately every 30 feet over a road that was about 10 miles long. And the sight of some 1,700 people dying in agony on crosses left an indelible impression on the mind of Jesus as a teenager, and on the mind of anybody else who experienced the horror of that. And Skip Gray concluded in his book, long before Jesus' death, the cross was an ugly, hideous reality. Man, you think about it. Once you're nailed to a cross, man, there's no going back. I mean, that's it, right? It's the last step. It's the final destination. The cross was a clear and a crude image of death. The Roman soldiers were really good at what they did. Jesus said, you want to follow me? You got to have a cross in your hands. Now, it is much more likely that we will be called to live for Christ than to die for Christ. But if we aren't willing to die for Christ, the question is, are we really living for Christ? I mean, does that make sense? It's like, probably we will not be asked to die for Christ. We will probably be called instead to live for Christ. But if we aren't willing to die for Christ, then the question is, are we really living for Christ? See, it's about holding on loosely to the world. It's about walking with Christ wherever he asks us to go. You know, I hear people talk about sometimes their cross to bear, like it's some kind of ache or pain, it's a minor inconvenience. Everything from an unhappy marriage to seasonal allergies are people's cross to bear. Anything that makes me uncomfortable is my cross. I don't think that's what Jesus was talking about. Jesus said, look, we surrender our lives to him. He is in charge. He may ask us to do hard things. He may ask us to do sacrificial things. He may ask us to do the ultimate kind of things that change our lives as we know it. But those things are worth doing because of the privilege of belonging to Christ and all the promises that are going to come from that. His promises make the sacrifice worth it. It's like the video that we watched a minute ago. Lancelot says, to be a great swordsman, you got to study your opponent until you know what he's going to do before he does it. You have to know the point in every fight, whether you're either going to win or lose, and you have to wait for that moment. And thirdly, you have to not care if you live or die. Carrying a cross means saying yes to Jesus regardless of the consequences. Am I willing to say yes no matter what? Before you sign up, before you jump in the baptistry, you need to know what you're signing up for. You got to count the cost. Jesus gave us a couple of examples of counting the cost. He said in Luke 14:28, suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Now, there is some application here to the importance of planning, that we need to be wise about our finances. We don't want to get ourselves in over our head. Before you start a building, you need to make sure that you have the resources to complete it. This goes for individuals building a house. It goes for churches, you know, building a building. Probably most of us have seen property somewhere that had a sign on it for a church that says future home of, and it names the church. And that sign sits there for 5 or 6 years as a testimony to the hopes and dreams of this church. And over time, the sign fades, and then it falls over, and eventually the future home of sign gets replaced by a for sale sign. Now, I get it. Plans change. But sometimes we start projects and we haven't counted the cost. And so I think Jesus' words here speak to the importance of making sure that you're ready to finish a project before you start a project. That's a good point. But in the context here, Jesus is really talking more about our surrender to him than he's talking about how to build a building. He says you got to count the cost. Before you get in the water, before you start your journey with Jesus, you need to know what you're getting into. See, it's comforting to know that God is in charge because he's a lot smarter than we are, but it's sobering to know that God's in charge because if he is, I'm not. And I like to be in charge. But he gets to call the shots. And he may ask me to do some things that are really uncomfortable for me. In fact, there's another illustration here that Jesus gives in verse 31. He says, look, suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he's not able, He will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off. He'll ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Now, again, the imagery here suggests that we have a responsibility to be followers of Christ. That means that we're ready if war comes. That we realize that, oh, going to church, becoming a Christian is not like a shrewd strategic move so you can build up your business contacts. Going to church is not a weekly dose of chicken soup for the soul. We are declaring, I'm all in. God is going to have all of me, that I'm making a covenant that I'm going to honor the Lord with my life. Now, is that going to happen 24/7 for the rest of your life? Man, I wish. But life is messier than that. Transformation is slower than that. Surrender is tougher than that. The problem with offering ourselves as living sacrifices, as the Bible says, is that living sacrifices keep crawling off the altar. We put ourselves up there and then we go AWOL. Because we're going to fail sometimes. We're going to struggle sometimes. We're going to be that soldier in the battle who turns and runs sometimes. But God is the master of second chances and of tenth chances and of hundredth chances. That's the beauty of the gospel. It's never too late to get back in the fight. And let me say this too, because I don't want you to misunderstand. It's not like I'm saying that if you give your life to Jesus, you get to be miserable for the rest of your life. He's going to make you do all the stuff you hate, and it's going to be terrible, but one day you get to go to heaven. I mean, I just don't think it's like that. We get to live the most exciting, purposeful, fulfilling life that you can imagine. If you want to be miserable, I'll tell you exactly how to be miserable. Give your life to Jesus and then argue with him every step of the way. Or put one foot in the church and keep one foot in the world and try to stay comfortable. It's like trying to stand up in two canoes at the same time. You can do it for a minute, but it's going to get uncomfortable. If you want to be miserable, that's a ticket. Surrender makes life better and it makes life harder. Both. But friends, better with harder is still better. I've told you before that my life verse is Acts 20:24. I consider my life worth nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace. Now, several years ago, I got that tattooed on my leg, and the tattoo artist said, so what's that verse say? And I started saying it. It was kind of a long verse, and he checked out before I got to the end. And so now, for people who don't look like they really want to know too much, too long, I always just say, my life testifies to God's grace. That's the summary of Acts 20:24. Does my life always testify to God's grace? I wish, but it doesn't. Does proclaiming the gospel of God's grace always take center stage in my life? It doesn't. That's why daily surrender is so important. It's why we renew our commitment every day, because surrender is hard. And that kind of brings us to this third responsibility based on the privileges that we have as followers of Jesus here in chapter 14. Consistency is the third thing. Look at verse 34. Jesus says, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It's thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Salt is good, Jesus says, and it is. Salt is good. Salt flavors food. Salt preserves meat. Salt even melts ice. I mean, don't even make popcorn if you don't have salt, you know? I mean, and lots of butter too, but I digress. I'm just saying, salt is a good thing. And like salt, we're the salt of the earth, Jesus says. We flavor the lives of other people around us. That's the goal. We melt the ice of division and hostility between people. We even can preserve other people by sharing the gospel with them and letting Jesus save them. Those are objectives that are fundamental to us as a church. We are the salt of the earth. The challenge is maintaining that over a long period of time. Jesus says sometimes salt just kind of goes flat. And I think about all the challenges right now with COVID-19 stuff and social distancing. It is easier to just kind of withdraw and disconnect than it is to do the hard work of staying consistently connected with each other and with God during times like this. I've seen it over and over again. We just withdraw so much that it's hard to even get out of our shell anymore. And the danger is that we can just start to kind of blend in and have no influence at all. I've talked to you before about the idea of camouflage Christians, that we just blend in so much that we don't stand up, we don't speak out about anything. It's like the student who was in a military academy. One of his instructors saw him at the mess hall and said, "Connor, I have not seen you in camouflage class in weeks." He said, "Yes, sir, it's my best subject. Don't want to be seen. Want to blend in." And losing our saltiness can mean that we don't show up anymore. Losing our saltiness can mean that we kind of go through the motions on Sunday and we live like the devil the rest of the week. Losing our saltiness, I think, can even mean that we withdraw so much from the corruption of the world that we no longer have influence on anybody that looks different than us, that believes differently than us. We get safe and tucked away, whether it's in our living room watching a service or whether it's here safe with all of our Christian friends, and we forget that we're supposed to have influence out there. We're supposed to be salt out there. Consistency is about maintaining our character. It's about maintaining our attitude, our morality, our faithfulness. It's about maintaining impact. And it's doing that no matter what's going on around us. There's a steadiness to who we are and to what we stand for. So here's what I want you to think about. I want to ask you a question. What's getting the best of you? Now, sometimes when we ask that question, what we mean is, you know, what's either driving you crazy or what's trying to take over your life? You know, my anger gets the best of me sometimes, we say. Or don't let her get the best of you. But I'm asking you that question literally. What is getting the best of you? What are you giving your best to? Is it your family? Is it your job? Is it sports or is it music or is it physical fitness? What's getting your best? See, here's what I want you to see, and this is the bottom line for today. You give your best to what matters most. You give your best to what matters most. I mean, you and I, we give the best of ourselves to the thing that is most important to us. We give our best to what matters most. If God's not at the top of that list, then our priorities are upside down, our surrender is in question, and our consistency is not going to hold up because we give our best to what matters most. Now, because this is 4th of July weekend, I thought we ought to wrap up today with a story of a patriot. So I want to talk just for a second about a guy that I know you've heard of, Nathan Hale. I learned this week that Nathan Hale was born in 1755. He went to Yale University, get this, when he was 14 years old. His brother was going, so his mom and dad sent him along too. He got into Yale. He graduated when he was 18, and he became a school teacher. He also accepted George Washington's request to be a spy. And this was in the very earliest days of spying for the U.S. He was a terrible spy. He was not the least bit equipped or trained to be a spy. So at 21 years old, he's behind enemy lines. He's caught by the British, and he's sentenced to be hanged. And he is credited as saying, just before he died, "I regret that I have but one life to give for my country." And some people have suggested that he was paraphrasing a line from one of his favorite plays. The line in the play said, "What pity is it that we can die but once to serve our country? I regret that I have but one life to give for my country." But a British officer who witnessed his execution later wrote in his journal something else that Nathan Hale said. It said, this British officer said he desired the spectators to be at all times prepared to meet death, no matter what shape it might appear. He's getting ready to be put to death, and he tells his audience that they need to be prepared to die. See, we know that Nathan Hale was a faithful follower of Christ. We know that he was outspoken against slavery, and we know that he loved his country. So they put his face on a stamp. And it's not like our goal is to have our face on a stamp. But you know what? They only put people's faces on a stamp who did something, who stood for something, who stood up for something. And whether history remembers us or not, that's what we want to do. That's who we want to be. We want to remember that you give your best to what matters most. And so we think about our priorities, and we think about our surrender, we think about our consistency. Now, in just a second, I'm going to pray, but we're going to do something a little bit different with our closing prayer today. I came across a prayer this week, and I'm going to share it with you. And I'm going to invite you, if you're comfortable, that I'm going to give it to you a phrase at a time, and if you want to say it out loud in response, if you want to pray it out loud, you can. You don't have to. But I want to invite you to do that as we close. So I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. And I'm going to see if you want to pray this prayer. Lord, help me to stand, not fall. Help me to be true, not false. To be courageous, not afraid. Help me to lift others up and not tear them down. And when I am tempted to quit, please bring to mind the memory of Jesus, who stood alone, who stayed courageous, and who went all the way to the cross for me. Amen. It's decision time. That's how we end every week. It's an opportunity for us to reflect on what we've talked about today. And these are some tough verses. But I hope that this is an opportunity for us to kind of do a little gut check and say, you know what, I probably need some more focus in my life, need to work on my priorities, need to tweak a few things. Maybe you're rolling along great right now. Praise the Lord. Maybe you need to make a sort of a decisive step toward Christ, and you want to talk about that. I'd be glad to talk with you. But I'm going to invite you right now to come or to stand, and then we'll sing this together.
I need you, oh, I so teach my soul to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Oh Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Man, thanks so much for being here today. Just a couple things I want to remind you about. First of all, next Sunday, Mark Mobley is going to be preaching. The Sunday after that, Dave Hamlin from Shelby Christian Church, one of our strategic partnership churches, is going to be here. I really want to encourage you to be here the next couple of weeks just to be supportive of these guys. And as we have seen, I know it's a holiday weekend, we're kind of down today, but we've been getting more and more crowded. And so 3 weeks from today, now make sure you either don't listen at all to what I'm about to say or that you listen carefully, because otherwise you're going to think this is starting next Sunday, and it's not. 3 weeks from today, on July 26th, okay, we're going to have three services just to accommodate the social distancing and as more and more people come back. So we're going to have our 8:30 service, still traditional. We're going to try 10 and 11:30. And we're going to see how that goes, okay? We'll stay flexible. We may have to make some changes, but the plan right now on the 26th is going to be 8:30, 10, and 11:30. We'll be sending out texts and reminders and putting that on Facebook, but I just wanted to let you know. And the last thing I want to say is that I love how we love to hang out together, but we do have people who are very conscious about social distancing, so I'm just going to ask that we not do like the holy huddle in the lobby as you leave, and then people have to walk through that. Go on out the doors if you don't mind. Stay and talk all afternoon. But it would be really great if we could just kind of filter out. Okay? Love you guys. Thanks so much for being here. I'll see you in, well, three Sundays. Okay? Thanks.